Good afternoon, everybody. Aloha kākou. My name is Kyle Kajihiro. I want to thank you all for coming to this teach-in on militarization and resistance in the Pacific in the age of Trump, right? And that's the kind of the climate we have to address. I want to welcome you to the Access Room. This is part of the College of Social Science. It's a student lounge. It's a place where we coordinate service learning. And we do lots of other events and meetings and stuff. So if you're a student, or even if you're not, you need a cool place to come and, you know, study, hang out, have a meeting, heat up your lunch, this is a place you can use. So welcome. And we want to thank the Access Center for allowing us to use the space. First of all, I just want to say a little bit about Hi, come in. Hi. I just want to acknowledge up front that the three of us who are slated to speak today, myself, I'm Kyle Kajihiro with Oceania Rising and also with Hawaii Peace and Justice, Ken Gofiga and Cooper, also with Oceania Rising and from Guam, and Pete Shimazaki, doctor, with the Veterans for Peace and the Hawaii-Okinawa Alliance. We didn't plan for it to be all guys, so I want to apologize for that, because there are women who are in this struggle doing kick-ass stuff, including Terry Keiko'olani here with the Women's Voices, Women Speak, working on the Women's International Women's Network against militarism, and they're actually in preparation for an international meeting in Okinawa. So hopefully she can share some of the work that she's doing, you know, after we do this. And this mic is not a... It's not for amplification, it's for Olelo community television. So if you can't hear or whatever, just raise your hand so it's not the technology that's failing. If Orin's taping for broadcast, so if anyone's not comfortable with that, just wave your hand and let him know so he doesn't. We're gonna try not to include any of the audience, but we wanted to just capture the speaking so that we could share it with more folks, yeah? So if everyone's okay with that. Let's see. The age of Trump, he's done a lot of horrible things, in my opinion, that is, harming many constituencies in the United States and around the world. One of the issues that has made a little blip in the news, but not a whole lot, is his policy around militarization, his foreign policies, right? So he's talking about the largest military buildup since, when was it? I think maybe Vietnam was what they said. $54 billion, yeah? It's gonna be a huge buildup. And as we'll talk about a little bit today, whenever the military, whenever there's a military expansion, it always affects Native Hawaiians, Native Hawaiian lands, and then it emanates from a place like Hawaii, which is kind of in the center, to affect other islands and other peoples around the region. And so we're here to kind of talk about those connections, not only in terms of the connections of how the military is affecting these chains of islands, but also how peoples on these islands are forming networks of solidarity to resist and to fight back. And so we have some really great speakers. We're gonna start out with Pete Shimazaki, doctor, who has been active in doing solidarity with Okinawa and building solidarity from Okinawa to Hawaii, and also Hawaii to Okinawa. One of the sites that is gonna be heavily affected by the Trump agenda, but just to note that it didn't start with Trump, right? This is the pivot began with Obama, but in this region, it went way back over 100 years, right, to the Spanish-American War and beyond, when imperial power started to expand across the Pacific. So it's the latest iteration of this very old process. So Pete's gonna give us some update on what's the situation today, and so please welcome Pete Shimazaki, doctor.
Aloha mai kako. Hai saigusio, greetings everyone. My name is Pete Shimazaki, doctor. As you can see from my shirt, I am a prior military service, but for now, I'm gonna be focusing on Okinawa, my ancestral motherland, my second generation Okinawan American, product of war in Okinawa. My father having been in the Battle of Okinawa and a Marine there for over 27 years, spent a lot of time in Okinawa, various wars, and myself My mother was one of the many civilians that survived war in Okinawa, of which about 1 in 3 didn't. So this issue of war in Okinawa is a very deep one. I could speak for hours, but I'm going to try to keep it to 5-10 minutes. So I apologize in advance for generalizing a lot and speeding through some things, because I got to go pick up my daughter from preschool soon. So I'm just being honest with you guys. And to keep me reined in from not talking too much either, I have some things, something maybe to keep me a little more focused, because I just came up here to share a few things about Okinawa. Maybe first of all, I should just point out, I'm not going to make assumption how much background knowledge people have about Okinawa. I'll just start off by saying Okinawa is much like Hawaii. It was an independent island nation, sovereign nation, with its own foreign policy and so forth, and it was unilaterally colonized by foreign power. In their case, Japan. In fact, Okinawa is more a Japanese name for Okinawa. It was formerly known as Luchu or Ryukyu. But anyways, it's important to start off there because that therein lies the relationships of Okinawa today. It was a colony, and like Hawaii, it was incorporated as part of the nation unilaterally. And yet it still continues to be treated as a military colony, and the people, and indigenous people, continue to be treated as second-class citizenship. I actually used to live, let's see, Oceanside over there, about over here. This is one of the many bases in Okinawa. Almost 18% of Okinawa Island is controlled, dominated by military facilities. And the thing I should mention about Okinawa is we're talking about an island around the size of Kauai, with a population larger than Hawaii. So you can imagine the incredible density. As you can see, it's urban jungle, and then you have these huge bases in there, of which a lot of problems come with that. Maybe I'll just run through some of the problems real quickly.
Can you like go on that side so people can see?
Sure, I could. Is that okay? All right. I was, because this man over here, the camera, asked me to stand over there. Okay. Whoa, I only pressed it once. Okay. Well, to begin with, like I said, there's several facilities throughout Okinawa, most 19% of the island, and some of the best lands. And I must say that a lot of this land was acquired through what they say bayonets and bulldozers. Well, either it was land that was seized by the Japanese forces that were militarized for the Japanese side. And then if you're familiar with the Battle of Okinawa, again, which devastated Okinawa to this day, that land was continued by U.S. military. Or while Okinawans were in refugee camps and records were destroyed, they were able to obtain the best lands in Okinawa. And just looking at one base, Futenma Air Base, an example of some of the problems, just looking at one. Around this base are schools, elementary schools. My grandfather was a principal at one of the schools that he was a principal at. In 1953, I believe, a jet fighter crashed into that elementary school, Miyamori Elementary School, and killing several children and staff. That is a day in the life of Okinawans, this constant threat of accidents. And the university here, I don't know if you guys can see here, but these are just examples of just some of the reasons why there's a lot of resistance to bases in Okinawa. And I should mention also that it's not just the land, but you can see there's tremendous air and sea space. This is an issue in terms of not just justice issues, but even for industry. So you see, this place does not have much autonomy, despite supposedly being a democracy. Consistently, polls over years, I've been involved in this issue over 20 years now, about 80% of the population, conservative figures, support some form of demilitarization for multiple reasons. There's a lot of accidents that come with training. On average, so I'm just showing you some boring data, but to show that there's evidence for some of these things as I move on. Official records show there's at least three accidents. These are just from training. We have accidents here in Hawaii. But you look at the proximity of the civilian population to the bases, and so there's a history of civilians being caught up in these accidents. Crime. Some of you may have heard of some notorious rapes and other incidents, murders happening in Okinawa. Those are some of the egregious examples, of which there are many. But there's also other just day-to-day crime on a monthly average of 13 a month. Okay, you got to consider the U.S. military is a significantly small population of the Okinawa, a small island already, and yet they do account for a significant degree of problems in Okinawa, traffic accidents and so forth. And just to kind of just give you guys a background idea, again, I'm trying to be brief on this. So it's not just inconvenience. There is a real threat to day-to-day life. The thing with that I want to point out with the crime, this is, I'm presuming some of you might have some background knowledge about Okinawa, some couple updates I was asked to give. Recently, there was, to the military's credit, they did an internal sting operation. And in summary, what it was they've arrested several Marines, service members, in a pedophile sting operation. What the military did was set up operations where they basically set up meetings with military service members in Okinawa who were under the impression they were going to meet a 13 or 14-year-old girl in some cafe for a little meeting that started on the online, and then they would show up and then they would be arrested. So that's just an example of kind of the day-to-day threat to civilians from crime. Kind of outrageously, the response to that in the defense of the military has been, oh, these poor service members were just bored online and they were lured by these military officials as pretending to be 13-year-old girls, and that they were unjustly lured into these meetings, which, you know, just leads me as a parent going, okay, at what point when you find out the person you're talking to is 13, 14-year-old, do you decide like, okay, this is inappropriate? So it's kind of interesting to hear people defending the military by saying that they're unjustly tricked into these pedophile experiences and so forth. Okay, let me just go, and if you're wondering where this information comes, it comes from the Okinawa government, official records and so forth. One other small point I want to talk about briefly about why there's so much resistance to military, besides just militarism itself, the destructiveness of war, is this is usually a conservative argument for bases, whether it's in Hawaii or in Okinawa. Some people take the position, a militarist position, that the good from the military comes from economic benefits. That's what Hawaii is about. What I will summarize about this data here, in summary, is what is shown is that land that was formerly used by the military and returned to civilian use, we have a couple examples, the economic, it had a multiplier effect economically. So translation, they found that the local economy would be stronger if it was in civilian hands and development, not military bases. That military bases is a very inefficient form of economy, and it's actually hurting the local economy there. Why am I bringing this up about a militarization form? Is one, besides that's usually the argument for bases, but two, to just raise the point that what we're looking at in Okinawa is not an ideologically driven movement. You have conservatives, progressives in the middle in Okinawa, all united, from the governor down to the grassroots citizens on this. A lot of the Chamber of Commerce type community are also united against bases because of this effect, this chilling effect on the economy. Okay, so I want to stay off this, and then maybe I can start wrapping up to some other updates and maybe some questions, and I can pass the mic to the next speaker. A couple updates. We have an official political prisoner, by definition, an Okinawan, Yamashiro Hiroji. He's been imprisoned unjustly 10 months after the crime event. I could go on and on in details. I'll just summarize. Amnesty has identified this gentleman as a bona fide case as a political prisoner. He's been denied bail, has been denied access to family, he's been denied proper medical attention, even though he's suffering from cancer, and on and on. This is the Japanese government arbitrarily arresting people. And this he wasn't arbitrarily, he was a pacifist movement leader who had been out tirelessly, like many Okinawans, some decades now, rallying against the military bases in Okinawa. And we can only see from the attention by Japan is to suppress the resistance there, because it has had the effect of people being scared about being arrested and detained for sustained periods, that has had a chilling effect on the right to express themselves in Okinawa. Other things that I might share an update is we're very concerned. We're talking about this militarism in the age of Trump. As many of you know about, Trump's been calling a lot of attention to the South China Seas. And there is a concern, a very real concern, that this could bring war again to Okinawa, which has had, again, the effect of destroying much of the island and life in Okinawa, which is really the underlying motivation to be opposed to these bases, that nothing really is good coming from it. They claim that the military is there, U.S. military and Japanese military, is there to defend Okinawa. Okay, here's the problem with that. They're using Okinawa as a forward deployment base. They're going to wars in Korea, Vietnam, Afghanistan, Iraq, wars that have not directly threatened Okinawa, yet Okinawa is threatened because countries like North Korea are pointing weapons at places like Okinawa because they got U.S. military weapons pointed at them. That brings the civilian population a great threat, much like Pu'uloa or Pearl Harbor did for locals here by drawing that military attack by the Japanese military versus another military. So this is a very real thing now, this saber rattling between the nationalists in China and the nationalists in America, pushing us to the brink of war. That's a very real concern, not theoretical. The irony of this is that in the meanwhile, while the leadership in Japan to United States and China in this region, while we're speaking, there is historical numbers of Chinese tourists coming to Okinawa now, buying up everything in sight, much like we see a lot of Chinese tourists now here in Hawaii. And while their saber rattling is jeopardizing our security through war and also economic security, in the meanwhile, we have situations like this where Chinese are coming to Okinawa and enjoying themselves and enriching the economy. Again, I'm not promoting tourism here. I'm just pointing out what's happening in Okinawa right now. And the point is that these opportunities to secure peace in Okinawa are being threatened by outside powers, United States, Japan, and China. I'm binding myself to keep it limited, so I might be helpful if I just pause right now to ask if anyone has any specific or general questions about Okinawa. So, because I can talk about a lot of things, and I'd rather not. I just talk about things that are of concern to people. Does anyone have any specific questions about Okinawa? Its relationship to here? Why is there anything? Okay, well, maybe, yes, thanks. Yes, okay. So what's a concern now as I get into that? I don't have any pictures of Henoko on the slides. So what's happening currently right now is it's really complicated. So how can I summarize this? One of the most dangerous bases in the entire world, Futenma Air Base, Marine Corps Air Base, identified by the U.S. is right in the middle of this urban center. I showed you that picture. Their proposal is we'll close down that base out of our concern for the Okinawan people, out of their democratic demands, but we're going to need another facility, and they're insisting that replacement facility is right back in Okinawa. So again, there's you have this demand from Okinawa, like, hey, I should have mentioned this at the beginning. Sorry. Okay, the country of Japan, Okinawa consists of 0.6% of the entire Japan land base, and yet it hosts almost 75% of U.S. bases in Japan. So in other words, all these foreign base occupation, they're all concentrated in Okinawa, that is a former colony, and they continue to treat it as such. Now, the proposal is to build expand a naval port in a region called Henoko, Okinawa, in the rural north of Okinawa. And to make a long short, maybe I can help this way. You guys know, what's the big, Haunama Bay? Sorry, just a lot of stuff on my mind right now. Imagine taking Haunama Bay and literally, not exaggerating, filling it with hundreds of tons of concrete to build yet another military facility, considering how many we already have in Hawaii. That's what's happening in Okinawa right now. Now, they've been able to stave this off through resistance, people literally in kayaks blocking construction crews, putting rocks in the road. It's been ongoing for over 20 years now. The U.S. and Japan government had promised that it would be completed by now, but it's still been stalled until this time. They fought it in court. They fought it with civil disobedience. They fought it in elections. And where we're at in 2017 is U.S. and Japan are saying, sorry, we are doing this. It's a national security matter. And that's a hard one to push. How are they getting away with this? Let me leave this with you folks. Is how this has been able to go on for not 10, 20, but 70 years now that Okinawa has been occupied. It is this. So, like Hawaii is part of, technically a part of the United States, Okinawa has been incorporated into Japan. Okay, unilaterally, it's illegal, but they did it, just like Hawaii. And what Japan argues is like, oh, we have this security treatment with the United States, that we have these bases here under our pacifist constitution. In other words, Japan says, well, our constitution says we have to minimize our military, so we got to count on the United States for our military defense. We have this treaty, okay? So whenever the issue of bases in Okinawa comes up from Okinawa, Japan will say, well, actually, it's the United States. They're the ones insisting on the bases, and it's their bases, and we can't do anything as the Japanese government. We have to abide by this treaty. And so when Okinawans approach the United States government, then it's like, oh, you know, this is actually an internal issue between your Okinawan government and the Japanese government, and that's a domestic issue that you guys need to worry. We're just these outside help abiding by the laws of the Japanese government. So if it make a really crass analogy, it's kind of like two parents of an unwanted child, maybe an unwanted orphan, who are like, don't talk to me, talk to the mom. And the mom says, don't talk to me, talk to the dad. And both escape taking any responsibility what's going on in Okinawa. So we're asking your support, not just this one political prisoner, Yamashiro. His case is actually coming up soon, March 18th, so maybe we'll hear something about that. But in the meanwhile, we really need your support, like here in Hawaii, to just stop more militarism, more military development. And yeah, I really got to go soon. So is there any other questions or, you know, thing I didn't hit on? Okay. Well,
what's the difference, you think, between the current Abe government and previous governments? Are they becoming more militarized as a nation, Japan, under Abe?
Short answer, yes. Abe is a standout in not just historic, he has ties to, but we all know that Japan was a fascist country. Right, just like the U.S. too, but and Germany, and those fascist tendencies are still in Japan, and really embodied by Abe with this kind of ultra-nationalist kind of thing about who's one of the first heads of state Trump met with, right, and had this, like, you know, wonderful honeymoon and together that weekend golfing. So the short answer is, not only is the current Japanese government, even because previous, just like, it doesn't matter if there's a Republican or a Democrat, they've all supported the bases in Okinawa, similar to Japan. So I want to focus on one party. It's not a partisan issue. That being said, Abe is very dangerous because we're talking about a neo-fascist regime that has its ties into culture. Like, they're talking about revering the emperor and, you know, not just politics and economics, but even culturally, Japanese supremacy, if you will. Yes, this is true, but I'm not going to go too much. You know, all of us have ancestors, you know, we can't be accountable for. So even avoiding that history, you're right. But I'm just talking about now, there's a lot of controversy about the leadership now. And it's a relationship with, maybe this is a good way to end this up too, is the pivot into Asia, okay? You know, currently Trump has been against the TPP, okay? So, but they've been trying to secure this relationship with Japan. And what is geared towards is a trilateral military alliance, Korea, Japan, and the United States. And it's creating a new Cold War and instability in a region, economically, politically, as we can see today. It's a real serious, it's not a conspiracy theory. This is really an issue we need to watch. If there's no other questions, I want to pass this on to some of these other warriors, because with this struggles are interdependent, and we're in solidarity with all the other struggles around the world. Thanks.
Thanks, Pete. So as a result of the struggle of Okinawans against this these military bases, the U.S. had to recalibrate its policy to try to move some of the troops out of Okinawa and into other places, right? So one of the places that's been hit really hard with that realignment is Guam in the Northern Marianas. And so to speak next is Ken Gofigan Cooper. He's going to talk about what's happening in his homeland, how it relates to militarization in the age of Trump. So, mahalo.
All right, hafade, todos hamzu, gwawsi Kenneth Gofigan Cooper, tata gwawhanzu, sidus masini fenetun midzu pagu. Thank you all for coming. I'm Ken Gofigan Cooper from the future independent country of Guam. And just want to tell you all about my homeland. So, this is where I'm from, all right? The island of Guahan, okay? Beautiful sunsets, quote unquote hospitable people, right? And I say that because I think we need to be a little less hospitable at times, which is the whole purpose of this presentation. But yes, so this is where I'm from. Guahan means we have in the Chamorro language. We are the indigenous peoples, the Chamorros. Our ancestors believe that the land had everything, and the land of the ocean had everything that we had. So Guahan means we have. Unfortunately, we are now having a lot more of things that we don't want. And it's changing the entire meaning. So Guam is also where American colonialism continues. What do I mean by that? It's during the introduction to this entire panel, Kyle mentioned that this is not a Trump issue or Obama issue. It didn't start from there. Like, this is all the way to the Spanish-American War, right? This is absolutely the truth. And Guam is this little vestige of colonialism out in the Pacific. So, what are we? We are something called an unincorporated territory, all right? That means, that we have no voting representation in Congress. We have no voting representative in the Electoral College, so none of you can blame us on Trump, okay? We had nothing to do with that. And we are under the full and complete legislative authority of Congress. If Congress doesn't want something to happen, they won't let it happen, okay? Now, the way that this began, right, is in something called the Insular Cases. But before we get to that, I want to quote these two awesome people here. Tyrone Titanos says, the relationship of Guam to the states is very similar to the relationship of the 13 colonies to King George. That's very disturbing to us. And in Guam, there is this movement that maybe we should just become a state. However, as a scholar of the Insular Cases, Bartolomé Sparrow has says, new territories might never become states if Congress did not want them to be, okay? So it's important to understand that like 31 of the 50 states were territories with the intention of becoming states and incorporated. We were not. So after the Spanish-American War, they get us, they get Puerto Rico, they get the Philippines. And the question became, does the Constitution follow the flag? And so there was these cases starting in 1901 called the Insular Cases, which pretty much argued, nah. They are pretty much brown people who do not understand Anglo-Saxon principles of civilization, all right? So the Insular Cases were in order to enable the United States to acquire and govern its new possessions without promising them either statehood or independence. We can do what you want. Pete said, you know, it's like the mother and the father fighting. With us, it's like, you know, there's no need to fight. We like you when we like you, but you're not really part of us, okay? So the inhabitants of territory acquired by the United States are not entitled to the benefits, privileges, and immunities of the Constitution until Congress sees fit to extend these rights. So we all know the Republicans dominate Congress now, but even the Democrats did. This probably wouldn't change. So what we're hoping is that this is a larger colonial institutional issue, and that having Trump in this exacerbates and makes everything worse. But even if Hillary was in, this wouldn't be automatically alleviated. So that's what I'm hoping to communicate today. So what is our relationship to the United States? We're neither foreign nor fully part of the United States, but rather something called foreign in a domestic sense. So it's kind of like if you all had, like, let's say we're kids, right? And you got that like awesome parking spot at your high school or something like that, and I wanted to like park there all the time, I'd be your friend to get your parking spot and ask, you know, do you mind if I just park here every now and then? But I really didn't like you, you know? And if I'm never gonna invite you to my parties, that's kind of the relationship it's like right now, okay? It's pretty much a relationship of abuse, all right? That's what it is. Our relationship to the United States is one of colonialism, oppression, domination, and ultimately a complete shoveling of our rights and self-determination struggles. So it all stems from this. The U.S. Constitution, Article 4, Section 3, Clause 2, this is something called the Territorial Clause, which states that the Congress shall have power to dispose of and make all needful rules and regulations respecting their territory or other property belonging to the United States. So that's where it comes from. Now, you might be asking, this is about the military. What does this have to do with that? Well, it's all interconnected. The reason why they are able to make these unilateral decisions is because we do not possess the political power or sovereignty to counter it. You know, we have the people power, and that's very important. But on the political level, we are a part of the United States, and we are their tip of the spear, okay? This is our quality of life. You don't have to read all of this, right? But it's to point out that our current political status makes us, our suicide rates 50% higher than the United States. 41.4% of our native Pacific Islander students felt sad or hopeless. 19.3% attempted suicide. Our per capita rate of forcible rape is more than twice the national average. Almost half of our federal funds goes to food stamp and goes to Medicaid. And there were 536 Chamorros, who make up 42% of the total houseless population in Guam. This is our current reality of our people. And the military is seen as the dream. It's seen as the thing to aspire to join so you can get out of this poverty. But it's a vicious cycle that actually never solves itself. So what about the military? Where are they in Guam? Well, they're all over, okay? We are at the tip of the spear of the American military saber, as Pete said. So we're also not only where America's day begins, where America's colonialism continues, but we are also where America's war begins. 27 or even 28% of the island is currently occupied by the United States military. And a lot of that land that they acquired was pretty much stealing land after World War II from Chamorros, okay? We are a strategic location. That has always been the reason for them to be here. In 1898, they acquired us, they used us as a coaling station, and then eventually, right, we're seeing, it's all about strategy. It's all about the curse of geography that we are forced to suffer through as of now. But hopefully, when I end this presentation, we can imagine geography in a different manner of solidarity. So we are the tip of the spear. We are the Fortress Pacific, America's unsinkable aircraft carrier in the Pacific. These are all terms that are referred to Guam. So Guam, we have, is now tip of the spear. And as my friend, Dr. Michael Lujan Bavacqua says, the tip of the spear always sees first blood. So what do we really want for our homeland? What do I want for my two-year-old daughter? Do I want her to be the tip of the spear? Absolutely not, okay? We have all of them. You know, we have like the checklist of like military stuff. B1, B2s, B-52s, the THAAD, which is the Terminal High Altitude Defense System, okay? We have a home port that sees nuclear submarines. We have a Naval Ordnance Annex. The whole north of the island is the Air Force Base. The southern half, you have the Navy Base. And I'm nowhere near done, okay? Does anyone know what this is? Wow, that went everywhere. Okay, does anyone know what that is? Okay, I'm gonna go over here real quick. Okay, right, does anyone know what this is? This is called the DF-26. It's China's first intermediate ballistic missile, which pretty much has the capability to reach Guam. It's also dubbed the Guam Killer. Okay, so imagine, we're a population of around 160,000 people. Most of the time we're pretty chill, you know, but yet we have Chinese dubbed missiles, the Guam Killer. We have missiles that are capable of reaching Guam. Why? Why attack Guam? Always refers back to the military, right? And we can see this happen. I remember when these folks here, North Korea, okay, if the U.S. is reckless, misjudging the trend of the times and the strategic position of the DPRK, all the U.S. military bases and the operational theater in the Pacific, including Guam, will face ruin in the face of all-out attack to be mounted by the army of the DPRK. Another quote, the U.S. should not forget that the Anderson Air Force Base on Guam, where the B-52s take off, and naval bases in Japan proper, and Okinawa, where nuclear-powered submarines are launched, are within the striking range of the DPRK's precision strike means. So, I remember when all this news was coming out, you had people on Facebook and social media saying, thank God the U.S. military is here. They're going to protect us from these threats. And I countered, saying, why the hell are these threats here to begin with in Guam? It's exactly the United States military presence. And so we have to rethink that. We have to reimagine ways outside of this military mindset that the military is there to protect. The fact the military makes everything so much more dangerous. So, you know, Pete was saying the new Cold War, you know, I mean, you hear about people hiding under their desks, afraid of the Soviet Union. But imagine in Guam, every few months you get a threat. You get a new threat. I remember one time my mom sitting back there. I was at a lavender farm on Maui. It was quite beautiful. But she called me crying because North Korea made a threat. And she asked to keep Guam in my thoughts. And that really hurt. It hurt that families back home who just want to live their lives and hopefully be a sovereign, independent people have to deal with the geopolitical tensions. We are pawns in a game that we don't even want to be a part of. We also face land contamination. This is a very, very detailed chart of all the land contaminations that have happened in Guam. Guam's cancer rates are really, really high, especially with nasopharyngeal cancer. And most recently, a bunch of veterans have come out saying that they have sprayed Agent Orange in Guam. But the Department of Defense refuses to acknowledge this, okay? Refuses to acknowledge this. And in the north, where the Anderson Air Force Base is, that's where our aquifer is. That's where the water is. That's where we drink, okay? And so right now, we're in the midst of this investigation because a lot of veterans have come out saying that they sprayed Agent Orange. But if they continue to deny it, the Department of Defense, we're going to keep fighting back and demanding more rigorous investigations into this, and maybe coming from our own people. The military says that they've done their own investigations and they found nothing. Well, duh, right? So this is what we're going through. But this is only Guam. I come from a Marianas archipelago. There's also the Marianas Range Complex, which was pretty much passed in 2010. It's 500,000 nautical square miles, all right? Give that into perspective, it's three times the size of California. 500,000 nautical square miles. And what it does, it gives the military a playground for live fire exercises and weapon testing, such as submarine warfare, sonar technology development, et cetera, et cetera. And sometimes in Guam, we do have beached wells, okay? So if this was not enough, 5 years later, they said, we're gonna up the ante. And they went through with the Marianas Islands testing and training. So it went from 500,000 square miles, okay, to 984,000 nautical square miles. So this is larger than the states of Washington, Oregon, California, Idaho, Nevada, Arizona, Montana, and New Mexico combined. And now that's their playground, okay, to do the same thing. All right, live fire, high impact underwater weapons, and deadly sonar, which will kill precious marine life, right? So not only do they want the land, they want our ocean, they want our waters. So everything is under threat. This is a picture of the island that they bombed called Farallon de Mindanizo, or No'os in the indigenous Chamorro name. They originally got this with an agreement with what is now called the Commonwealth of the Northern Mariana Islands, and their lease on the island expires, I believe, 2033, but they can have a unilateral extension if they wanted to, I think, to 2083. Now, I want to show you a video. This is from the YouTube U.S. military channel, so they're just openly flaunting it. This is them bombing that island. That's what happens. Now, with the MIT that passed in 2015, they're going to drop about, if I'm not mistaken, around close to 6,000 bombs a year on the island. On an interview that my friends in We Are Guahan did with some fishermen that are sort of near there, sometimes they say that during the bombing, they can hear the island cracking. Okay? They can hear the island cracking. So, this is a Marianas-wide issue. And if this ever shows up again, I'll go on further with my presentation. But so here it is. This is a picture of it. Okay, this is the entire MIT range. So it expands all the way like near Palau. But keep in mind, this is why I even gave political status in the beginning. The MIT study area does not include the sovereign territory or territorial seas of the FSM or Palau. Okay, so even though the FSM and Palau are yes, prone to military establishments because of their compacts of free association, the fact that they're quote-unquote independent nations does give them some defense against full-on domination by the United States, just putting whatever they want, wherever they want. Now, in the Northern Islands, there's also the CNMI Joint Military Training. This is, I know Carolyn and your husband has been very, very helpful with this struggle, and there's been a lot of campus events. So Pagan is an island north of Guam, north of Saipan. And they pretty much want to take the northern half to train and bomb. Okay, live firing ranges, amphibious exercises, grenade launchers, rocket mortars, missiles, airdrop bombs up to 1,000 pounds. Okay, this is Pagan. And we are trying to say that this is absolutely ridiculous. Before this, we had the threat of Pagan. Was that, you know, everyone know the nuclear accident that occurred in Japan, right, with Fukushima? There was originally a bill in the legislation of the CNMI that was going to put nuclear, all the dump waste, and they were going to turn Pagan into a dump waste for the debris from that incident. And the CNMI people were like, no, okay? Even though that was introduced within their own legislature, right? But when this came out, you saw a lot more people come out and be like, no, absolutely not. There were people living in Pagan, but there was a volcanic eruption in 1981, if I'm not mistaken, 1981, 1986, I think it's 81, and they moved all of them to the pretty much Saipan. So people still claim that as their home. It's just with the volcanic eruption, you know, it was dangerous. Six people around still live there now. They went back. Right, and these six people go back and forth from Saipan, but they claim it as their home. So we're not talking about some uninhabited island. But even if that was the case, that island is ours. So, you know, that doesn't apply to you, right? Just because something is devoid of people doesn't mean that you can take it, okay? Just like if you left your house, it doesn't give me the right to go into yours. Now, the island where there are a few thousand people is Tinian. And they want to take the northern two-thirds of the island for live firing ranges. Does anyone know the importance of Tinian in World War II history? Pretty much, that's where the nuclear bombs were loaded into the planes that bombed Japan. Okay, so I've actually visited the northern half of the island and saw the nuclear missile silos. Okay, so the military took that northern two-thirds of the island, right? Initially, they were going to develop a base, but that didn't go through. It actually did make people upset because they were looking for the economic possibilities of a base. But now they want to take it and pretty much hold off the population from accessing this area around 20 weeks a year. Okay. Now, with all this amphibious exercises, with all of this ammunition, they only have one aquifer over there. And so there's a lot of worry from the EPA and from the local people saying that the Navy has failed to mention the true effects that it's going to have on the aquifer. Okay, that's drinking water. Deborah Fleming, who is a hotel owner and also part of a lawsuit against the Department of Defense, saying we believed in America, and instead what they want to do is destroy our island. That's how we feel. A lot of us felt like that before. I was happy to be raised into a generation that never felt that patriotic because I was raised in a history of knowing our oppression, but for like my grandmother's generation, who was quote unquote liberated after World War II, she thought America was everything. She thought Americans were the answer to everything. They were the saviors. But when I tell her about these things, I tell her about the land taking that happened, she feels completely betrayed. How can a liberator come into your home, take you, it's kind of like this. Let me put this into perspective. Let's say that someone was robbing you, okay, robbing your house. I'm walking by, I see the person robbing you, I run in, kick his ass, okay, and then go on to say that because I did that, I now have rights to live in your house. That's exactly the logic that's happening here. The military, quote unquote, liberated Guam, and now I'm gonna take it, it's mine. I can stay here, I saved you. And a lot of our people actually do think that that's a valid reason, but for a lot of us, it's absolutely not. All right. So lastly, what I wanna talk about is the Mariana Islands Guam military relocation, which is the one most sort of pressing for our island where I'm from. So originally there was a proposal to bring 8,000 Marines and their dependents to Guam. We had a lawsuit. The military, Department of Defense, sort of much said, okay, we'll drop it, we'll find another location. Now they said, okay, 5,000 then. Okay. So 5,000 Marines, they're gonna build a Marine base in what is quote federal land in Finnegadon. And what they wanna do is they wanna build another firing range, but something called the surface danger zone is over Letekzan. Okay, Letekzan is pretty much, they found some of the oldest Chamorro artifacts there recently. And there's a lot of medicine around that area. There are 30 of these trees, and the mother tree is right in their surface danger zone. There are only 30 of them in the world, and they only exist in Guam and Rota. So that area is rich. It's where the wildlife refuge is, okay? Now, I wanna explain why this is what we're fighting for. With all of that military overview, a lot of us have said that the answer is independence, that we need to fight for our independence as a sovereign nation, and then we can go to critique the nation state, and we can destroy the nation state after we get it. But we have to have the ability to kill our own nation state first. So we're fighting for that. What do we mean by independence? To exercise self-government over one's territory and population, to have sovereignty and to participate on the world stage as equals, and lastly, to create a government that can work for us. This is nothing that we have now. Our government was created through a 1950 Organic Act by the United States Congress, okay? So we didn't get to formulate that government the way that speaks to us and how we interact with each other, how our relationships dictate cultural norms, social values, none of that. That's what we want. We want to be able to become a neutral country. We want to be able to form alliances with Oceania and independent Pacific nations to say, keep out of our ocean. Stop contaminating it, stop threatening our people, stop using us as a pawn in your imperial games. But we can only really do that if we become an independent nation, right? On that stage. Granted, we are not gonna stop with the people power and the affinity geopolitics, as Sasha Davis says, before that, but this is something that we strive to do. So independence does not mean isolation. It instead allows Guam to enter a network of global interdependence as an equal partner rather than a possession of another. And so what I'm hoping to do here is ask of all of you for two things. Number one, check out Oceania Rising, which is our local group here at UH Manoa that speaks about these issues. If you are interested in meeting and talking about this and building networks of solidarity and planning events, please come see us after the event. Kyle and I will be here. This is some of the meetings that we've had, right? Freedom is Oceania Rising. And also, if you could please sign this petition. That's a long to write, but if you type in Protehile Texan, it's a petition to save Ratidian from the degradation and militarization of native lands. A lot of our Omut farmers, a lot of our healers back home just had a walk through that area to show the importance of the medicinal plants that are there. But we need everyone's help with this. We need everyone's help to help us fight the militarization of our lands. And support us. We are fighting for independence, and we need to help show the people of Guam that this is feasible, that we have support from around the world. So you can email me here, visit our websites. We have Instagram. We're trying to keep up with the times, yeah. But yes, pretty much, if I can leave you with anything today, it is this. This is the ads. Our ancestors used this to carve canoes that sailed the ocean wide and established relationships with fellow Pacific nations. What we're doing is that this ads has been taken from us, and futures have been carved by the United States military that are nuclear, that are dangerous, that threaten the lives of my daughter and her children, that threaten the physical integrity of our actual island because of bombing, that threaten the ability for our people to self-determine what we want to do. And so in taking back the ads, I envision us carving a new future, and that only happens if we take an approach of solidarity in Oceania. When Oceania comes together and says, I may seem like a small island, but have you seen the ocean and how large it is? Have you seen my brothers and sisters in Kiribati? Have you seen my brothers and sisters in Aotearoa? Have you seen my brothers and sisters in the Solomon Islands, in Palau, et cetera, et cetera? And together, we will ensure that your military, that your imperial agenda will never succeed here. So, on this campus, let's start to form that dream. Sizus Masi.
Hello, everybody. So I'm Kyle Kajihiro. I work with Ken and others in Oceania Rising. I'm also a grad student in geography. And before that, I used to work with the Hawaii Peace and Justice and the American Friends Service Committee. And one of the things we worked on was addressing the military impacts in Hawaii and in the region. So I'm going to talk about Hawaii as the pivot of U.S. empire building in the Pacific and try to connect it up to the talks that Ken and Pete gave. I'll start with the Hawaiian historian David Malo. He prophesied in 1848, I think, that when the high tide rises, large fish will come from the dark sea, and when they see the small fish in the shallow water, they will eat the small fish. So what do you think he was talking about? What was his reference to? This is an early period in Hawaiian kingdom history, but he was already seeing the colonial scramble for the Pacific, and he knew that Hawaii was in their sights, right? So he was making a warning to the rulers of Hawaii to watch out for empire builders, right? And Hawaii was vulnerable to this. So fast forward a few years to 1873, General John Schofield and his entourage makes a sort of a visit to the islands. They're cruising around the islands, and in this so-called diplomatic mission, they're actually doing secret military reconnaissance. So he writes back to his superiors that it is the key to the Central Pacific Ocean, It is the gem of these islands, valueless to them, Native Hawaiians, because they cannot use it, but more valuable to the United States than all else the islands have to give. What do you think, what particular geography do you think that he's referring to in this? Guess?
Pearl Harbor.
Pearl Harbor, right? Or what was originally named Ke Awalao o Pu'uloa, the many bays of Pu'uloa, the Pearl Waters, the Avava Lei, the lay of valleys and harbors, right? Place where it was very important to female deities, right? Kala'i Manuia was a queen that helped to build fish ponds, Ka'ahu Pahau, the shark goddess, that protected the people of Oahu from man-eaters, and Kanekua Ana, the mo'o wahine, who brought the fish, all the abundance to this place, right? This is a place of abundance and fertility. And if you look at this old map from 1873, you can see the many, many fish ponds all along the water here. Most of these are now been filled in. And all of these areas that are kind of darkened, those are all indicating wetlands. So because Pu'uloa is at the convergence of two mountain ranges, right? The Waianae Range on one side, Ko'ola Range on the other, and about 12 different watersheds draining into it. It had a lot of fresh water, which meant that this place was very momona. Yeah, it was very rich, it was full of life, and very productive. And so this was the highest concentration of fish ponds. You can see the fish ponds in here. Highest concentration of fish ponds on Oahu. And as a result, this place could be considered the food basket of Oahu. Yeah, it was one of the places that made Oahu productive and relatively peaceful, right? Because they didn't have to fight over resources. But Pu'uloa also became the centerpiece, the object of desire for the United States planners, military planners, and politicians. And it became the kind of the centerpiece in the whole controversy around the taking of Hawaii, right? Which begins with the Bayonet Constitution in 1887, right, that disenfranchises the majority of Native Hawaiians. And as a result of that, the white-controlled cabinet agrees to a free trade agreement that grants the United States exclusive access to Pu'uloa in exchange for this trade, reducing the tariff on Hawaiian sugar. When the Queen, Liliuokalani, tries to reverse this Bayonet Constitution, this is when the second act of the takeover happens in 1893. We have the so-called overthrow of the Hawaiian Kingdom backed by United States troops, right? So the Marines land at Honolulu Harbor, they march up Mililani Street, and they point their Gatling guns at the Iolani Palace, right? So this small group of white businessmen could seize power because they were backed by the muscle of the United States military. And this is where the broken relationship begins for Hawaii and the United States. It begins with a military intervention, it begins with a regime change that becomes the first of many regime changes in U.S. history, right? Hawaii was the prototype for this type of policy to take place. And despite resistance by Native Hawaiians to annexation, the Spanish-American War breaks out in 1898, and Hawaii becomes a military necessity. So this begins one of the themes in this history that Haunani Trask talks about. So whenever the United States goes to war, they take more Hawaiian land. Right? The U.S. takes Hawaiian land. And as a result of this moment in time, Hawaii helps the United States. We become the stepping stone for the United States to move from a continental base, a land-based empire, into an overseas empire. And this cartoon from that era indicates that kind of ambition from the Caribbean all the way to Manila, right? Under the eagle's wings. But we are sort of the pivot of that transformation. So if you remember your physics, right? Every pivot needs a fulcrum, right? If you ever have to lift a heavy object, you put something under it, you use a lever, and you can lift it much easier because of that fulcrum. So I would argue that Hawaii plays a similar kind of role geopolitically for the United States. We become a fulcrum of military and imperial power to project outwards. And as a result of the United States taking Hawaii, the United States could also take Guam and the Philippines in that same motion, right? And travel graphics. Sorry about that. This is a logo for the United States Pacific Command. And so, you know, 100 years later, and they're using the same logo, basically, of the Eagle. This is Hawaii is now the headquarters of the oldest and largest of the U.S. Unified Commands, right? Headquartered in Halawa Heights above Pearl Harbor. Its area of responsibility goes everywhere from the west coast of North America all the way to the central Indian Ocean, from Alaska all the way to and including Antarctica, right? So most of the area of the planet and the majority of the population of the Earth falls within this area of responsibility right here. And so I'll headquarter right there. So the metaphor that Kalekuakaeo, a professor of Hawaiian Studies in Maui College and an activist, he said that you could think of Hawaii as the head of a monstrous head. If you think about the military in Hawaii, it's like the head of this octopus, right? As tentacles are reaching out all over the Pacific. This is what it looks like on our islands. The red and yellow areas are the kind of current and the recent expansion of military lands. The orange or peach colored are former military lands. So the height of military expansion here was during World War II. They had about 645,000 acres of land in Hawaii. Today it's about 240, well, this is a little bit low. I think it's closer to 240, about 142 military sites. And if you look at Oahu Island, it's about a quarter of our island is under military control. So a lot of that you might not notice because it's up in the hills, but you know, we have one of the highest concentrations of military land tenure, you know, close to Guam and Okinawa, I think, are the other two that are comparable. These brains of this octopus can be imagined as the supercomputers and the command center. This is up at Halawa Heights, where the Pacific Command is located. Their command center, you know, with their flat panel screens, the supercomputer in Maui, and all the fiber optics that connect this stuff is like the nervous system. Yeah? The eyes of this octopus, up on top of Maui, they have a tracking station for the Air Force in Koke'e, Kauai, Ka'ena Point, and even that floating golf ball that comes in and out of Pearl Harbor is part of this network of sensors that they have, remote sensors. So that's a sea-based X-band radar, if you don't know, and it's about a $5 billion project. It's a very expensive experimental radar. It's really powerful, and it's meant to protect against missile strikes. So in the same way that Guam gets sort of used to justify militarization, right, and North Korea gets kind of used also as the antagonist in this drama. Whenever North Korea talks about doing another missile launch, this thing gets trotted out and towed somewhere in the Pacific to protect us, right? Even though the only reason why North Korea would have a missile aimed at us is, as Ken said, you know, because we've got missiles pointing at them, right? But it works. It doesn't work well, and it's been critiqued by the General Accounting Office, and other experts have said it's a very expensive boondoggle, right? But if you think of it as a device for creating military contracts and continuing military contracts, it works really well. Because every year they get new money, the defense contractors get new money to improve it. So incremental improvements gives you a long-term lifespan on this kind of a project. The ears of this octopus, sensors off the ocean of Kauai, and over in the central Oahu, we have the Naval Computer Telecommunications Area Master Station, NCTAMS, and also the National Security Agency Regional Signal Intelligence Center. Right. So if you've heard of Edward Snowden, the guy who blew the whistle on NSA spying and capturing all of our electronic communications, he worked in one of these bunkers underground, you know, that was filtering through all of our communications. Right. The excrement of an octopus like this is widespread. It can be symbolized by what happened to Pu'uloa, right? Once the food basket is now a giant superfund, which is a government list of the most toxic and priority areas for environmental cleanup. Everything from, you know, PCB and heavy metals, mercury, lead, radioactive cobalt-60, fuel spills, solvents like perchloroethylene, and sadly, the pearl oysters is now extinct. And so if you go to the shoreline, you'll see signs like this. And one of the most recent incidents we've had is if you go over the Monolo Freeway towards the stadium, you'll pass over what's called Red Hill, or the Hawaiian name is Kapu'ukaki. Under this hill are 20 of these giant fuel tanks. Each one is 250 feet high by 100 foot in diameter. The Aloha Tower would fit inside of one of these, right? There are 20 of these tanks buried in the mountain, running a tunnel with a pipeline and a small railroad runs underground from there all the way to Pearl Harbor. And each tank holds 12.4 million gallons of fuel. Okay. So this was built in secret during World War II. It's still being used, even though over the years they start breaking down and they've had leaks. I think every single tank has leaked over the years. And the latest one in 2014 was 27,000 gallons of jet fuel leaked out. The tanks, you gotta understand that these tanks are 150 feet above the Halawa Aquifer. Okay? The bottom of the tank is 150 feet. So 12.4 million gallons times 20, 150 feet over the aquifer. And this aquifer is one of the main sources of fresh water for Honolulu. It provides 24% of the water from Waianae to Hawaii Kai. So we're all implicated by this threat. The violence is also indicated by things like the destruction of Hawaiian sites. And this picture here is from in Mokapu on the Kaneohe Marine Base. These sand dunes are called Heleloa. It's one of the largest Native Hawaiian burial sites in the Hawaiian Islands. And so they're literally golfing on the bones of Hawaiian ancestors. Several thousand human remains were removed for a runway that kind of cuts through this area. They're in boxes at the Bishop Museum. Terry's been involved in efforts to try to repatriate these bones. So these are all the kind of the negative effects that spill over from the military presence that they never really tell you about, right? Violations of civil rights and liberties. So in the age of Trump, I think they have a lot to be concerned about this. And Hawaii hasn't had prior experience of martial law for 3 years during World War II, during which time land was condemned for military exercises, and persons of Japanese ancestry were put in concentration camps, right? Several thousand were put in camps. The other aspect is, I think it's really important to understand how militarization is part of a process of forced assimilation, right? Our Native Hawaiians and Japanese immigrants in Hawaii were kind of put through military training as a way of making them loyal subjects, to become sort of confused. Junior ROTC was implemented. One of the first schools in the country was actually Kamehameha Schools, right? A Native Hawaiian school. The second one was McKinley High School, which was Tokyo High, because of so many Japanese children in there. And the idea behind that was how to make them better Americans, right? How to incorporate them into U.S. society. Some of the other spillover effects, economics. So we hear a lot about the military economy, and it is a large part of the economy. But another way you could look at it is the dependency that kind of warps our economic viability in the long run, right? So things like housing is one example where military housing subsidies, which could be a couple to maybe $4,000 extra a month for housing, gives an advantage to the military renter or home buyer, which tends to inflate the cost of housing, right? We already have one of the highest costs of living because of the housing crisis, and we have this exploding homelessness problem in the islands. That's related, I think, right? No one's really kind of analyzed it in that way, but we've been saying that we have to look at how the economy gets distorted by these sort of factors. Accidents, a constant problem. Violence against women that sort of spills over from these bases. We know that it happens a lot in Korea and Okinawa and the Philippines. In Hawaii it also happens, but we haven't had systematic analysis or study of these phenomena. So that's one area that needs more research. And then the tentacles are reaching out to Okinawa and Guam, Kwajalein, Korea, and other places, right? And so it centers here, and I guess this is another theme that comes up, is here we have to, I think, be responsible for two aspects. One is the violence of the military occupation in Hawaii on the people and on the land, but also on the consequences of this military occupation for other people around the region,
right, who host the bases, or who are the targets of war and other kinds of military intervention, right? And if you're a fisherman, you ever caught tako or hehe, if you cut off a tentacle, it'll grow back, right? So in the Philippines, the bases were kicked out, but they're coming back. After September 11, advisors in Mindanao, with the conflict in the South China Sea, an expansion of the visiting forces agreement to allow more U.S. presence in the Philippines. So we have to deal with the problem at the head. Some of the recent expansions that have happened, the Stryker Brigade was a 25,000 acre land grab. We weren't able to stop it despite many challenges to that. But recently, because of the financial downsizing of the military, they moved the Strikers out. So in a way, we won, but they still took the land. Right? The land was still taken. Missile defense, Ken mentioned the THAAD system. They just recently said they're going to start building a THAAD a missile complex in Korea, which the Koreans are very much against, because it's going to upset the balance of power with China. Right? China is very concerned about these. And Hawaii, it plays home to one of the largest training areas in the island. So this becomes a big playground for the defense contractors to test their wares.
No one knows where that is.
This is on the west side of Kauai at Polihale Beach and Nohili. The Osprey tilt rotor aircraft is another recent expansion. It will be homeported at Kanyohe Marine Base, but training will occur in many locations throughout the islands. So this is now, we begin to see these arriving. I think there's some Osprey on the island already, and not all of them yet, but pretty soon they'll be here. And so there's, Terry was involved in some opposition, but we haven't seen a huge resistance to this effort. Although this is the one that recently crashed in Waimanalo, if you remember a couple years ago. So it's very dangerous. Pohakuloa is the other site that's being targeted. It's one of the largest live fire ranges outside the US, and so this is where most of the live fire training is going to be moving to. There's all kinds of new developments out here, but also a new challenge from Native Hawaiians who are suing the state of Hawaii for its failure to protect these lands, which are being leased from the state to the military. And these are all lands of the Hawaiian trust lands, lands of the former lands of the Hawaiian kingdom that were taken over and are held in trust by the state. So this is an ongoing issue over there at Pohakuloa. Just a couple of examples of resistance that I think are symbols of hope and inspiration. Kaho'olawe was one effort where a small group of activists began the struggle, and it grew into a movement which eventually stopped the military from bombing Kaho'olawe, right? The smallest of the main Hawaiian islands. And so I think it is possible for small groups to leverage its power through networks. And it was really this kind of trans-oceanic solidarity with the nuclear-free and independent Pacific movement that helped put a lot of pressure on the United States and its allies to stop bombing Kaho'olawe. Right? So the bombing stopped in 1990, $400 million appropriated for cleanup, but only a tenth of the island is actually safe for kind of unrestricted access. Makua Valley is another site where there's ongoing struggle. It was taken during World War II. There's been a lot of protests. And in 1998, Malama Makua filed a lawsuit to challenge the armies for failing to do an environmental study. And because of that lawsuit and the kind of settlement agreement that was reached, the army's been actually constrained by the court for 14 years now. They haven't trained. So. You know, I think as time goes on, it's just proving the point that we've made that the valley's not needed for live fire training, but would be better as a place of Hawaiian restoration, right? Environmental restoration, cultural restoration. The group Malama Makua says this should be the University of Makua. It should be a place to learn how to restore the earth. And so we've had a ceremony there for 14 years now. We've had makahiki ceremonies in the valley. And so that's a sign of hope. And I think, you know, if there's opportunities to go to Makua twice a month through service learning, if anyone's interested in that, you know, you can talk to us. You don't get to see everything because they really can try to constrain us. But it's great to be able to get in the valley and see and touch these places, you know, and have the valley speak to you. So it's a beautiful place. And with that, I think that's my last slide. So with that, I'll just close by telling a brief story. Atwood Makanani is a Hawaiian activist and a voyager. He sailed on the Hokulea. And one time when I was driving in a car with him, he told me, "You got a haku," right? And I didn't know what he was talking about. And he was in Hawaiian, haku means like to braid something or to compose, right? And I was like, okay, I have to think about it. She speaks in cryptic ways like this. So I think what he was saying was, by weaving together the many strands of our struggles, we can make a robe, a strand that's much stronger than its individual parts. And hopefully this this thing that we braid together can be strong enough to catch and hold those big fish that threaten to eat us all. So thank you very much. So, any questions or comments? We wanted this to be sort of informal so that we could talk story and brainstorm, even if folks wanted to, talk about your ideas and thoughts on how to address these problems. Yes, Karen.
Yeah. A lot of the things with the Trump agenda now is to take away all of the EPA challenges and things like that. You have the EPA being basically disbanded. You have a new court system come in. And a lot of the things you were talking about actually were the victories were through the courts and the EPA, that there are some regulations, as bad as they are and as bad as EPA often is. Like, how do you see that coming down now? Because, like, for myself, I think it's going to have to be in the streets and it's going to have to be people, and we can't like rely on those things. And that's in a way, we shouldn't have relied on them any time at all. Most of the time we lost actually in the courts, but we did get some wins. And so like, how do you see the whole Trump agenda with the Pruitt administration and that kind of thing affecting these islands? Because you have, the huge expansion of military money, China as the big enemy, and then that money, it seems to me, will be put into the Pacific areas.
So yeah, Carolyn, exactly. I think the court cases have to be thought of as tactical. They're tools to get us to help us leverage the state and its laws, with Kahoolawe, with other struggles, Vieques, Puerto Rico, Okinawa, it's people doing direct action that have been able to break through, the hold of the state, right, on these places. Standing Rock, although it's going to get really dangerous and difficult in this time, because there's, they're removing any sort of constraints that they may have had against inflicting violence on the people, right? So, I think with Makua, we have to gear up for the possibility, because it's not done yet. Even though we've held off the training for this long, they could still start up. As soon as the court gives them the okay, they could theoretically begin training. I think it's going to be difficult for them politically to get that started again. So, but we have to be prepared to throw down if we need to. Yeah. You wanted to add something, Ken?
A lot of even with the struggle with Pawgut, right, it was a lot of invoking the environmental impact statements, right? So with the elimination of the EPA, that just make everything a lot more difficult, especially now with Agent Orange, and our struggle to sort of find out what's really going on. That's a huge problem, and so we're going to have to look through independent ways to, find the first Chamorro toxicologist, who'd be willing to do this stuff independent of that. But I also think the Trump agenda is making a lot of people scared back home. because it's really the geopolitical tensions are rising. And as I mentioned, you know, we've had these crosshairs on us during the Obama administration. And so to have like this megalomaniac as the president of the United States, and sort of the discourse he's invoking in enraging people, it's pretty scary for us too. And the only hope that I have is that maybe this will make people realize that we shouldn't be a part of this country anymore, that we can run our own country better, and that we, the decisions of a megalomaniac thousands of miles away won't, you know, the fact that that affects us so deeply is scary. And so hopefully that our people can realize this is our chance to form something better.
I mean, Duterte is an interesting character too, right? So, and in some ways, you know, he's almost like a mirror of Trump, and in other ways, he swears at Obama and the U.S. So, I don't know what is going to happen there. I think that the antagonism in the South China Sea, though, is being used by the United States to justify an increased, you know, military presence and a more belligerent attitude towards China, which is, I think, kind of dangerous. Although, you know, China is also doing stuff that's really unacceptable in terms of its kind of militarization. So, Philippines is going to be interesting. I don't know where the popular movements are in terms of opposing this. I think they're not as strong as they were maybe, you know, several decades ago.
The demonstrations against the U.S. this past week were huge, huge. And it was all against there's base expansion going on in the Philippines, and people are very angry. The whole prostitution issue is coming up from the women's group. So for Women's International Women's Day, the demonstrations were enormous, and they were focused by the women's groups on U.S. bases and the presence and control of the U.S. in the Philippines. So that's a really big issue. It also came up, it was interesting enough, in Australia, because Australia, they're expanding, they've put in a lot of new bases and military into Australia, and there's a quite vibrant movement there against it. So, you know, there are a lot of places that we haven't sort of conventionally looked at for anti-military, like Australia. That sort of came out of nowhere to some extent, you know, that they're actually taking a position against the military and against the appropriation of the land by the U.S. military in Australia. So,
in addition to the native people, the Aboriginal people, being opposed to the extraction of uranium,
yeah,
there's extensive uranium mining going on, and that uranium is used in
weaponry. So, and that's brought together in Australia quite a bit, the Aboriginal movements and the conservation movements. They're working much more strongly together than I've seen in the past.
Yeah.
So, you know, this Trump thing, I mean, the horror of it and everything else coming on, it should bring organizations together that we all have to stand together. I don't give a shit what our differences are, that what's in front of us is so horrendous that the organizations have to come together. And, you know, that doesn't mean we change our differences. We're going to have our differences. But with those differences, we have to figure out how to work against this. And I'm very concerned that a lot of the organizations and groups that are opposing the Trump agenda are not recognizing the military component of it. It's all the racism, the sexism, the bigotry, and things like that, which are horrendous. The bullying, the lies, the attacks on media, whatever. But the military issue is largely being left out of the conversation. And I'm very concerned about that. And I think that all of these groups that are doing the anti-Trump and stuff, this has to be part of the conversation.
I think, you know, there's American liberalism has never really challenged the militarization of the country, right? And its imperial wars.
Well, I think also American nationalism. Yeah. I mean, let's call it for what it is. And a lot of people don't want to see the so-called civil rights gone, not asking who those civil rights were for a lot of the times. And all of the other, you know, rights that are going away that most people, frankly, in the U.S. didn't even have anyway. But that's what's being fought for. And it's horrendous. It's being taken away from everybody. I'm not questioning that. But the military aspect and the threat to the people of the world from the U.S., it's very focused on a sort of national dialogue of, you know, let's keep America America. And America's always been fucked. And so why can't we say it like it is? And then, you know, look at what America has done historically, and then what America is doing, you know, to the tenth whatever magnitude now. Because whatever we fought for in the 60s, the 70s and stuff is in threat of being taken away. And, you know, but it really bothers me that people aren't looking what's going on the people of the world and the different islands and the Pacific and what's the, you know, what's all of that with the Trump agenda.
So back to your question for a little bit, too. The other thing that's, I think it's happening with the U.S., the way it's pivoting in this region, so because of the resistance in Okinawa, right, they want to push a lot of 9,000 Marines to Guam. There was a strong opposition from the Chamorros, and so that plan got sort of readjusted to, what is it, like 6,000? About 5,000 instead of 9, about 5,000, and then 2,500 to Australia on a sort of rotating basis up in the northern area. And then I think they're talking about 2,700 more to Hawaii. So sort of splitting up the relocation to these different locales. The other thing that's happening in the Philippines is these the Enhanced Visiting Forces Agreement, which creates greater rights for the U.S. to access ports and military sites in the Philippines on a kind of as-needed basis. So it's a new model of foreign military base. It's not the kind of mega base that you see in Germany or in Japan, where the U.S. you know kind of controls this huge real estate and polices it and has to manage it all. This would be like a Philippine base or port that the U.S. would pre-position its supplies there and would have access rights when they need it. So they can just flip the switch and turn it on and use it. And so it's this kind of new model that they're going to, I think, deploy to other parts of the world. We see it in Africa, too, a lot. There's a lot more of these small bases, austere bases, or lily pads, they call it. And so we have to watch that. And also the kind of mercenary armies that are coming up, right? The private military contractors that are being used, that are kind of in the gray zone between being military or just something else, right? And so do you count that as a military intervention? When they're just doing security details, is that a real military base if it's just some supplies and equipment, right? And so that's the thing we're seeing is these kinds of different gradations of militarization that can be just in time, you know, turned on when they need it.
How about the role of China and Oceania? Do we have any symbiotic relationship with the largest population in the world?
Well, I mean, China's a tricky one. I think China's been doing this whole dance to try to cultivate its diplomacy with Pacific nations, right? Giving aid and trying to veer nations off of recognition of Taiwan, right? Through aid. You know, I don't think it would. I think we need friendly relations with China in the region, but it's not like we pick China over the United States or anything like that, right? And we have to end this idea that peace and security is through some kind of hegemony, but rather through solidarities that we form and kind of political affinities, right? So
it always seems like I was saying, it always seems to be this game, like what power are we going to side with? And that's why I think we need to flip that entire model And Kyle and I always joke that, you know, an eye for an eye, imperialism for independence, in the truest sense, in Oceania independence, right? So there are definitely independent Pacific nation states right now, but what would happen if we supported each other's independence movements here, Hawaii, New Caledonia, Rapa Nui, you know, and what would it look like if we collectively became the, you know, we were responsible for our own defense. We became this neutral zone of a buffer that said, you know, foreign military, you're not allowed in here. But that also geopolitically might help the United States and Chinese military, because the Pacific isn't something that they have to worry about anymore. It's a complete buffer zone that they don't have to worry about someone intervening with. And so I think in order for us to stay independent, it would mean us establishing true, meaningful, non-hegemonic interdependencies with other countries in Oceania. So, yeah.
So that happens and the relationships are made.
Right.
They have cases, but like the French, the Australians, UK, maybe get that as moments notice. How do you work with that?
Sorry, the UK, them would what?
Like the militaries. I know for, so you have these previous colonial powers, yes.
Right, right.
And you're still working with a lot of publishing countries, a lot of Oceania countries. How do you make sure that the countries that are, that aren't independent or that are independent still keep their interests to themselves without having to deal with, or you would still deal with like outside interest in stuff, but how does that solidarity stay strong?
You know, I've been trying to think about this because a lot of people in Guam wanted the same thing, and I came up, this may seem controversial, but I came up with the idea of something called stonefish geopolitics. And a stonefish doesn't go out and try to sting other, you know, but if you come into its territory, it will harm you. And so I was looking at places like Estonia and the other Baltic states, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, that are like training every single day to prepare their own people for like a citizens' defense league. And so I think that there is a difference between militarization and having a martial character, right? Just because you know martial arts doesn't make you a bully. And so I was wondering, what would that look like in our ocean with us developing a sort of martial character that says, you know, if you do try to come in here, you will probably get stung pretty bad. So it would be safe if you just did it. It may be a pill too hard for you to swallow. And so that's why I'm looking at those places. I'm looking at cyber defense. So my whole dissertation is about how would an independent Guam defend itself without allying with China or the United States. And so I look to Estonia as a very good example, not only of a citizens' defense league, but the way that they're using portable government through cyber infrastructure is amazing. And so on an oceanic scale, I think there's a lot about the ocean that can really help us defend ourselves. You know, Palau, they burn fishing ships. They burned Vietnamese fishing ships that were like illegally fishing in their EEZ, their economic exclusive zone. So what are aspects of that that we can use? And, you know, our intention is not to go colonize other places, right? It's not to be imperial or build an empire, but rather be this place that like truly cares for the Pacific Ocean. So, but you're definitely right. There is the issue of, you know, realist power politics. Like, they have more military might than you. And, you know, that's definitely one, the goal would be to change that value entirely, right? And I think that Oceania can be the model for something else to exist. But on the other hand, I think the stonefish is a good model for just keeping that precaution as well, yeah.
Any other comments or questions? Ideas? Suggestions?
Thank you.